We are about to embark upon a series of strange and exciting dangerous adventures. Adventures that will lead us to all parts of the world.
Hello and welcome to another Bad Comic Review. This time we are looking at Empyre, Issue 1. This is a miniseries from Marvel Comics in 2020. Story by Al Ewing and Dan Slott. Script by Al Ewing. Art by Valerio, Schiti. Color artist Matre, Garcia. Letters by VC's Joe Caramagna. Cover by Jim Cheung and Frank Martin. Cover is okay, it's pretty boring though. It's a pinup. Assistant editor was Martin Biro. Associate editor Alana Smith. Editor Tom Brevoort. So we start out with the Fantastic Four flying toward the Kree Skrull fleet. They have a lot of long, boring conversation, which is not a good way to start your book. And we learn that the two have entered into an alliance with Hulkling at their head. Now, Hulkling is Theodore Altman. He was one of the Young Avengers back in the day, and he was in a relationship with Wiccan. They were early gay characters that they played that part up instead of giving them too much personality. Now, this miniseries does resolve one thing that really annoyed me, is that She-Hulk was dumb for a long time for no apparent reason. Well, they sort of fixed that. Finally, the Avengers are on the moon in the blue area where the Watcher used to hang out. And this used to be a Skrull sort of outpost where they were putting two races against each other, the Kree and the Kotati. And now the Kotati have returned and they are trying to live in the blue area. They've made this garden thing. It's run by Koi, which is short for Sequoia because originality is lacking these days. Well, the Kree and the Skrulls have come to destroy the Kotati and maybe Earth. It's a little unclear. The Fantastic Four is trying to talk to them, but the Avengers aren't real clear on what's going on. Nobody bothers to explain anything to each other, and they end up fighting. And most of the issue is a fight scene, which is actually pretty good. And we are left with a pretty messed up ending, actually. It was a twist that most people probably aren't going to see coming, but it's an obvious one. Really, a lot of the problems in the issue stem from lack of communication, people not wanting to explain what their position is to the other, and just being hotheads and rushing in. Overall, the story's not bad. My main complaint would be Mr. Fantastic's internal dialogue that they have in the caption boxes. He's constantly praising Sue, so they can't get away from the constant praising of the female characters instead of letting the characters show you how good they are. They have to fawn over them, and it's really tiresome. But that was really the main flaw with this. They did a good job capturing each person's personality beyond that and showing you that Sue was powerful, but they didn't need to sit there and spell it out. I thought that was really dumb. So overall, it's a pretty solid issue, actually. It's just not worth the cover price. I don't think it's worth $6. There's a lot of story here, but a lot of this could have been cut down to make it a $4 book. Like, the whole thing with Franklin Richards, who looks really weird through a lot of this issue, is kind of pointless. The entire aspect of that could have been taken out. Probably a quarter of this book was fluff, because there's a lot of dialogue that's pointless, like usual in Marvel Comics, but this is a little better, at least a lot of it's plot driven, but there's still a lot of fluff in here. So they could have cut enough pages out to make this a regular $4 book, and I think that would have been a much better book. Tighten it up a little. They have to do all this decompressed storytelling for the trade paperback to try and milk you out of an extra $10. And that's really what it is they're trying to milk you out of extra money. If they had tightened this up a little bit, eliminated some pages, and just given you references that this happened, the whole two or three pages with Valeria and Franklin leaving the Fantastic Four because of what's going on could have been summed up in one caption box instead of like three pages of nonsense, pointless drivel and teenage angst. So that's just one example of where they could have tightened it up. So I think the editors aren't really doing their job, or there's a dictate to try and make these things as fluffy as possible just to either bore you, make you hate them, or to get more money out of you, or all of the above. I will recommend it, but not at cover price. It's not worth $6. It's not a bad book. The art overall is pretty decent, except Franklin looks kind of weird sometimes, but it's really not $6 value to me. I would have been more comfortable paying $4 for it, maybe $5, but $6 is just too high. So if you could get it cheaper, I'd recommend it or wait for the trade. We'll see how it plays out. I'll pick up issue 2 because I thought it was an okay book otherwise. So that's just my take. Thank you so much for listening and supporting the channel. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss future reviews. If you'd like to help the channel in other ways, links to my Patreon, Teespring, and Streamlabs are in the description. And as always, we hope to see you on the next one.